Hello everyone, it is indeed a very blessed Friday. I am so excited to be here once again. I encourage you to keep on inviting more people so that we can get to start off. Meanwhile, let me just update the live session as you guys keep on coming live. And as usual, ensure you tag a friend, your crush, or anyone that you feel that will benefit from today's topic. Thank you so much. Marbley Feather, thank you so much for being on time. Keep tagging your friends. Keep inviting everybody in the group so that we can get to learn together. So let's keep going, let's keep coming, joining this live session. I think your presence. As I said, today's topic will be how to identify a business opportunity. Most of you usually post it as a question. I have XS amount. What business can I start with it? So we are going to tackle that question today, and I believe we shall all benefit, and most of all, you are going to use what you learned today to generate a business that is going to benefit you, benefit your community, and most of all, bring glory to our God. So without further ado, we shall start off right away with a word of prayer. So I would request you to close your eyes and bow down your heads wherever you are so we can start off. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you for this opportunity once again. As we get to learn on the various business dynamics that we can put into place, God. May you open our hearts, may you open our minds, and most of all, may you give us the grace to put it into action so that we can see results and bring glory to you. Father, bless everyone that will be watching this session. And to those that have not been able to join us today, God, even as they watch later on, may you open their minds, may you open their hearts, that they may understand every concept that we learned today. Father, we invite the Holy Spirit to move mightily in this session, all for your glory, my Father. In the mighty name of Jesus, we do pray, trusting and believing. Amen. So, I would say clap for Jesus, so you can clap virtually. And keep on inviting more people. As I can see, Sammy G. Mwaniki, I believe you are a moderator. Welcome, Sammy, and I believe you can tag as many people as possible. If you have a boys club, tag them here. If you have a girls club, bring them here. If you have some family members that you believe they would want to start a business in the near future, they need to watch us today. So, first of all, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank every one of you for the support that you've shown me through these live sessions, and to all those that keep on sending me feedback on my inbox on how these sessions have been transformative to in their financial lives. I really, really want to thank you and just say that God receives all the glory, for we can have nothing unless He gives it to us. So I'm so, so happy, and I really appreciate all of you for taking your time, for, you know, allowing yourself to learn and put everything in action. I just want to say thank you. I would also like to take this opportunity to thank our founder, Miss Akela and Mr. Diane, for creating such an amazing platform. We really appreciate you for obeying God's vision. And of course, I would like to take this opportunity to thank all the moderators. May God bless the work you do. You do a lot of work in the background, and we cannot pay you enough, but rather we can just speak a word of blessing upon your lives. So to start off, as I mentioned earlier, today's topic we are going to discuss on how can you identify a successful business opportunity. Most people usually frame that topic in form of a question by asking, I have XX amount, what business can I start? Others will say, I'm thinking, I would like to start a business, what is your view? What is your take on doing XX this? So, before I can go right into the extensive side of everything, I'd just like to give us a small analogy to help us understand the concept for today. Some few years ago, I happened to come across two people. These two people, they were doing the same business but in different locations. Now the problem was, one person, we'll call this person A, and the other one person B. So person A, who was in location A, his business was really thriving, while person B, who is in location B, the same business was not thriving. Remember, person A and B, they were doing the same business, they had the same tools, they were like opening hours were the same, form of adverts were kind of the same, but why was it that person B was not thriving while person A was thriving? After further research, I came to realize that there was a business law that person A was satisfying while person B was not satisfying. Just the same way we have the law of gravity, right? We have other laws, you know. I'm not good with those laws, but we have like the law of gravity. Anything that goes up has to come down. The same applies when it comes to business. We do have business laws, and there are business laws that are fundamental. It's like it's the backbone of everything. So in this scenario, as I said, person A was fulfilling a fundamental business law which person B was not fulfilling, and that is why, despite all of them doing the same, selling the same product and using the same mechanism, person A was thriving while person B was not thriving. So you might be asking, what is that business law? So the business law that that is fundamental when it comes to starting any type of business is learning to satisfy a market need. In my story, as I said, we came to the realization that person A, who was in market A, was fulfilling the business law of satisfying a market need in that market or location, while person B, despite having all the business tools, he was not satisfying a market need in his location. Okay, I'll give us a simple example. You might find a certain business is thriving very well in the US, but when you come to Africa, the same business is not thriving. You might find the person who is doing that business in US and the one who is doing in Africa, they both have the same tools, but the thing is, the person in US, he or she is satisfying a certain market need at that time, whereas in Africa, there is no market need for that business or product or service. So when it comes to identifying a business opportunity, it's very important for you to analyze and ensure that you are satisfying a market need. This is a very important business law, and it is a law that is that cuts across. So whether you go to Europe, whether you go to Africa, whether you go to Asia, when it comes to satisfying a market need, that is the backbone to having a successful business. Now, you may be asking, what is a market need? A market need, it's just something that people cannot stay without. So if in a certain market, for example, if I'm going to satisfy, let's say my market is, let's say South Africa. If I'm going to satisfy a certain need in South Africa, I need to know the South African market. How is it? What is it that people need so much that they can't stay without it? And if I offer my product or service fulfilling that need, I will get customers. So a market need is something that people cannot stay without. It is something that people are willing to pay any amount of money in order to have it. And give us another example. When coronavirus was starting, maybe around March, or let's say February, March, April, there was a market need for masks and sanitizers, right? Now, people were willing to pay any amount of money to get a mask. People were willing to pay any amount of money to have a sanitizer. So that right there was a market need. And to the people that took advantage of that market need, at that time, they were able to set up a business that that sells masks or creates masks, manufactures masks, a business that manufactures sanitizers or sells sanitizers, and they were able to make some money. However, as time goes by, you realize this market need is no longer that much, as people have now. It's not that Corona has disappeared, but there has been more people coming into the market. And I believe in the next 5 years, the business for masks and sanitizer will not be there. Now, that was just to explain to you what a market need is. So it is something that people are willing to pay any amount of money, any amount of money, just to get hold of it. Again, you can see, like, sometimes, especially in December, a lot of people want to travel. Now you find that the prices for transportation, maybe airfare, or if you're traveling by a bus, the ticket is usually high, and people keep on booking. This is because at that time there is a market need for transportation. So a market need is anything you can think about that people are willing to pay any amount of money to have it. So when you are thinking of starting a business, whether you are in Europe, whether you are in Asia, whether you are in Middle East, whether you are in Africa, wherever you are, consider the first fundamental law you need to ensure you are satisfying is a market need. Ask yourself, what market need am I satisfying? Then, how much are people willing to pay in order to get this product or service? I believe with that, we are able to now understand what a market need is. I'll read like some few comments if there are there. Okay, I can see Dennis, Ken, thank you so much for joining us. Sammy, thank you once again for joining. Caroline, thank you so much for joining in. Yvonne, I really see you're doing a great job. God bless you for that. Let's keep on inviting more people. Steven, welcome. Let's keep on coming on board. As I was saying, we have the first thing you need to do when it comes to identifying a business opportunity, wherever you are, is you need to satisfy a market need. As I said, a market need is whereby you are offering a product or service that people are willing to pay for any amount of money in order to get hold of it or to have it. So that is the business law that everyone needs to fulfill. And the reason why I'm insisting on this is because if you are able to fulfill this market need, chances are high you'll be able to stay in the market for a longer time as compared to somebody who is not fulfilling a market need. And this will answer the question why some people, as I started my story earlier, you'll find that a person is thriving in this business, while if you take the same business and put it somewhere else where there is no need for that product or service, chances are high your product is your business will not succeed. And this tells you why a lot of people will tell you business is a scam. I tried this business, I failed. I've tried this. No. The problem is not the business. The problem is you did not satisfy the business law of satisfying a market need. Just remember, we have laws. If you, even in any country, there are laws that govern a country. If you fail in any of the law, there will be repercussions for it, or there will be consequences that you have to suffer. The same applies when it comes to business. If you do not satisfy a market need, chances are high you will not be able to stay in business for long. And definitely, of course, there are other factors that determine how long a business can be, but the major one is satisfying a market need. Now, just to mention about a market need, there are two categories of a market need. The first one is a permanent need, and the second one is a seasonal need. So a permanent need is a need that will forever be there. People will forever eat. People will forever travel. People will forever do certain things. People will forever need a place to stay. They'll need to have a house. People will forever need to, you know, take care of themselves. Then there, so these are permanent needs, especially things like food. You cannot say that I'm eating today, then the next time I will eat is January 2021. No, you keep on, it's a continuous thing. So if you want to start a business, it's important for you to consider satisfying a permanent need and also touch on seasonal needs. I will give later on, I'll give us the reason why you need to satisfy both. So satisfying a permanent need, as I said, it is a need that will, it is a recurring need. It is a need that will be there after 1 year, after 2 years, after 3 years. It will continue to be there. Now, the advantage of satisfying a permanent need is because when you satisfy a permanent need, you are guaranteed to be in business for a longer period of time. Because this is something people need every day. Example, people need water every day. People need to drink water. These, you can't like drink water today, then say like, since I've drunk 2 liters of water today, I'll drink 2 liters of water next week. No. After some few hours, you'll feel thirsty and drink water again. So this is something that will continue to be there. Now, if you start a business that satisfies a permanent need, chances are very high you are going to be able to stay in business for a longer period of time as compared to someone who is satisfying a seasonal market need. Now, what is a seasonal market need? A seasonal market need is a need that is there for a short period of time, then it disappears. A good example is, during the rainy season, a lot of people tend to buy warm clothing. But after the rainy season has ended, or after the cold season has ended, most people do not buy warm clothing. An example, if you have an ice cream shop, during summer you sell a lot of ice cream. But when there is winter or during the rainy season, you cannot sell ice cream anymore. So that is a seasonal need. This is a need that is there just for a specific period of time. After that time is over, you will not have a market to buy your goods or services. Another example is right now, like this mask and sanitizer, trust me, we will not be forever wearing masks. This is something that is going to end immediately a vaccine is found for the virus. So anyone who is in the sanitizer mask business, they are satisfying a seasonal need, which after some time, it will not be there. And of course, we are praying that a solution is found for this virus. Now, the advantage of satisfying a seasonal need, which every business needs to have incorporated in their business, is because seasonal needs usually tend to have more profits because it's something that people want immediately. So if you are satisfying a permanent need, it's important for you to ensure you are also satisfying a seasonal need to take advantage of the profits at that time. Example, if I have a business that is selling basic food items, but right now, since there is a demand for mask and sanitizer, which is a seasonal need, as a smart business person, I will make sure in my business I have a sanitizer and I also have a mask. I'm selling mask so that I can take advantage of the profits that come with people demanding for mask and sanitizer. Then when when the demand for mask and sanitizer ends, my business will not end. My basic food business will still be there. So you'll find yourself, you are able to thrive throughout the year, not because you're satisfying a permanent need, but also because you're taking advantage of the random profits that seasonal needs bring. I pray that we are all understanding this concept. So it's important to have it's important to satisfy a permanent market need to ensure the longevity of your business and to ensure you stay in business for as long as you want. While at the same time, it's also important for you to satisfy a seasonal need so that you can take advantage of profits that come with the demand for such a product. Now, I think we've now understood what the number one business law that you need to satisfy when it comes to setting up a business. Then the second, we've come to break it down to what kind of needs there are, and I say there are two needs, a permanent and a seasonal market need, which you need to ensure you incorporate it in your business. Try as much as possible, whichever business you're starting. For example, you could realize that maybe in your locality right now, people need, people need something to do with digital products. Now, as you fulfill this need for digital products, ensure you add in a seasonal product or service in your business, such as training. So I could be selling to people digital products, right? But once I sell to them, they don't know how to use them. So I can offer a seasonal need, like training them how to use the digital product. So I'm getting profits from satisfying a permanent need, while at the same time, I'm earning more by training them, that is satisfying a seasonal need. We will get to the next section. To all those that are bringing in your comments, thank you so much. Keep on bringing your comments. Keep on writing your questions, as I'm trying my best so that we can get to have a session where I'll answer all your questions. So write all your questions right now. I will be answering them after I've finished with the discussion. So how do you create a market need, or how do you get to identify a market need? Identifying a market need is sometimes very easy, and sometimes it's very hard, and sometimes you can create a market need. So we'll start with the easiest way. The easiest way is identifying a market need. How do I identify a market need? You're able to identify a market need by getting to understand what is it that people lack or complain about in a certain locality. Now, you might be thinking, how will I know what people are complaining? It's very simple. You can go on social media. Let's say, for example, you want to identify a market need in Nairobi. I know Nairobi is a very big city, but if you want to identify a market need in Nairobi, you first of all explore and see what is it that people need so much, but they can't have it, yet they're willing to pay for more. So with technology, everything has been made easy. You can see through posts people make on social media. You can see through the news, because that is why we watch news. Personally, I watch news to see what is the trend in the market. You can also identify a market need by the conversation with the people around you. Sometimes you've heard people saying, I wish they maybe I wish I had someone who can deliver this product to me instead of me going to the market every day. Or maybe you may have heard people saying, if this thing could have been brought here, then life could have been easy. Now, it's very important when you seek to satisfy a market need using this method, because if you just find one person complaining about something, that complaint is not enough to create a sustainable business. So you might find, let's say in your estate, you only find one person who complains about internet. The others are okay. So you cannot say that you'll start an internet business just because of one person. So you need to ensure that the people who are in dire need of that item, you can be one of them. They are able to make the business viable or to sustain their business. Another way you can pinpoint a market need is maybe there's something you've been wanting a lot, and you try to see in your locality nobody is satisfying it. Now, what will you do? You might look into satisfying it because you've experienced it. A good example, let's say you've gone to a place and the service you've gotten there, it's very terrible or you didn't like it. Now, since you felt some type of way, you might decide to start offering that service and offer it to the standards you believe other people can like it. Now, another way of identifying a market need, as I said, is so this one is where you simply look around and see what people are complaining, and you choose to create a business based on that. Another way is by learning to create a need. Now, I will focus more on how we can create a need, because in the world that you are getting into, this is more important as compared to just watching what people want. I'll give us an example. You see, like Facebook, there was no need for Facebook in 2000 or in 1996. Nobody needed Facebook, right? Or nobody needed a smartphone. Like, there were in the 90s, nobody was complaining that my old phone is very tiresome and all that. People are not saying like they need a smartphone, but the founders of smartphones, the founders of Facebook, they created a need. Right now, I think at least 80% of the population in the world, they have at least a Facebook application in their phone, or even a WhatsApp or Instagram. So this clearly tells you that the founders of Facebook, they learned how to create a need. And that makes no difference between me and you. You can create a need and actually make people get hooked to your product. Now, how do you create a need? I will give us some few ways on how you can create a business need. Just a second. Yeah, we are on time. So, creating a business need, the first thing you need to do is through cost reduction. Now, there are products that you might find they are already there in the market, but the price is so expensive that a certain class of people are not able to afford it. Now, if you want to get into business, you do not necessarily have to invent something new. You can use that product that is being offered at a higher price, but now you offer it at a lower price. Trust me, every customer wants to save some money. That is a guarantee. Every customer wants to save some money. So if there is a product or service that you've seen somebody doing it and they have a market. However, the price they have is very high, such that there's a category of consumers that are being missed out. You can step in, offer the same service or product at a reduced price. A very good example is most of the billionaires in Africa, like let's say Dangote, they didn't invent something new. They actually did business selling an existing product. So you can sell that rice, you can sell cement, you can sell an existing product, but you'll make it a market need by reducing your prices so that people can get attracted to you. So cost reduction is one way you can create a need. I know most of us, we've had this mindset, or we've been told all the time, create something new, bring something new in the market, but I'm here to like really disregard that, because it's not all the time you'll have to invent. You can use an already existing invention and use cost reduction to make people want that product or service. The second way you can create a market need is by selling security and fear. Now, I know most of you will say we are children of God, we are not supposed to sell fear, but now I'll tell you, when it comes to the business world, people tend to, when you sell fear and security, most consumers will go to buy that product or service because they have fear and they want security. I'll give us an example. When there was the announcement of coronavirus, we saw people running to do panic shopping. What was the cause of that? The media sold fear. The media sold you'll have to stay indoors, you'll have to stay for as long as, you know, we don't know when, there will be lockdown for a long period of time. This led to a lot of people, this was fear being sold. So a market need was created for basic food items. Now, if you want to create a market need, you need to learn the techniques of creating fear so that people can realize the need of your product or service. Another way you can create security, I put them as one point because they go hand in hand. If you sell security, people are more likely to buy from you as compared to when you don't sell security. So how do I sell security? Selling security could be in terms of warranty. Imagine, I'll give us an example. Some of you, you've bought certain items just because they have a 1-year warranty, yet there was another brand of the same item, but they didn't have a warranty. So what did you buy? You did not buy the item. You bought the security, which is 1-year warranty. Example, if I'm going to buy a phone, whenever you go, we find people going to buy a phone, the first question is, what's the warranty? Or if you're going to buy an electronic item like a TV, the first thing you always ask, what's the warranty? And a smart business person, they usually create a longer warranty so that you can have the security and buy that item. So you find that more people will buy items that have a longer warranty security as compared to items that have lesser warranty. Trust me, most of the time these products or items, they are the same, but just because one businessman or woman is selling you the security, you get attracted to it. So one way you can create a market need and make people want to buy a product or service from you is by learning to create security. And as I said, one way you can create security is by giving a warranty. That is why you buy something that has a 1-year warranty and leave another one that has maybe 3 months warranty. The third way you can create Sorry, let me just have some water. The third way you can create a market need is learning to create greed. I tried to look for another term or better term to use, but I found the term greed being able to explain to us what it really means. Now, you create greed by example. You tell people, you will get this quickly. You see, you will be the first to do this. You'll be, you know, the quick thing. So if you tell people you're selling to them greed, then you create a market need that people will get attracted to you. Have you ever asked yourself, why is it that lotteries, despite having a lot of people losing and, you know, people getting a lot of stuff, still people go to participate in lottery? Have you ever asked yourself, why is it that anytime that there are a lot of scamming businesses, but still people give their money to them? It's because they sell greed. Most of us want things really quick. Now, I'm not saying you go and start a shoddy business. I'm not saying you go and start scamming people. What I'm saying is that make people have an urgency of an item. So you can, like, for example, you can create an item, then tell people with this item you're going to cook even faster than the normal way. Now that way you've created a need. A good example is the what do we call them? Nonstick pots. To be honest, ever since we were born, we have been cooking, right? We've been using pots to cook. But the person who introduced nonstick pots, what they did, they created a grid by making people understand with a nonstick pot, you don't have to spend a lot of time washing a pot after using, you know, you don't have to, you know, scrub and all that. All you need to do is after you cook, you just wash easily and put it aside. So people, they rushed to buy nonstick pots because they want to wash their dishes easily. The same case when it comes to pressure cookers. It's not that you can't cook with normal pots, but you find yourself buying a pressure cooker because you want to reduce the time you spend in your kitchen. So when you learn to create greed, like make people understand that with your product or service, they will be able to achieve something quickly, then that is a market need you're creating and people will start getting to buy you. Ever thought, why is it that most of the adverts you see, and I will actually ask you to watch an advert today, there are certain terms they use. The number one term is get it easily, faster. Maybe, do you need faster internet? Use this. Do you need to learn how to simply cook? Use this. You see, those terms, simple, faster, easily, quickly, that is a greed term. It makes you want that item really fast. So the third way you can create a market need. So the third way you can create a market need is niche markets. Now, when it comes to niche markets, or when you want to start a business, consider starting a business in a market opportunity that is smaller as compared to a bigger market opportunity. Why? This is because if you want to start a business in a bigger market opportunity, chances are high there are already big fish in those areas. So they might give you barriers to market entry. And that is why you find it's very hard to, we have parastatals in every country. Now it's very hard to overtake a parastatal because they have a bigger market niche. Now, for example, if you're in Kenya right now, if you tell me that you want to start a business of providing electricity, I'll ask you, how about Kenya Power? Because that is a big fish in that industry. How about KenGen? That is a big fish in that industry. So if you satisfy such a market need, chances are high there'll be many barriers to market entry that might make you give up easily or might drive you out of business. So as you choose to get into a certain business, focus on satisfying small market niche. A small market niche could be even within your locality. You could decide to start offering something like anything simple that is of a small market, then grow from there. But if you start like going big, there are big fish in that category or in that industry, so you'll experience more market barriers as compared to when you look into satisfying a small market. I always tell someone, if before you start a business, you need to ask yourself, who will be my customer? Now, you cannot tell me everyone is your customer, because you have to break it down and say, these are my customers. Maybe my customers are youth, age 18 to 28, or my customers are teenagers, age 10 to 16. So you need to market, to narrow down, and then realize what place can you really get more customers and be easy to get into. Another example is, there are certain businesses, if you want to start right now, the barriers to market entry are more as compared to other businesses. Example, if you want to open a hospital right now as your business, trust me, there are a lot of barriers to market entry, such as you'll be needed to do a lot of paperwork, a lot of capital, a lot of, you know, approvals. You need to seek all that, as compared to when you decide, I'm going to offer health consultancy services to teenagers age 13 to 20 for a certain maybe for psychology or, you know, counseling. Now, if you compare these two, they are business ideas, they are satisfying a certain need, but one of them, the market niche is big. Building a hospital is a big market niche, and you will have a lot of markets, barriers to market entry, as compared to when you decide, I'm going to focus on this small market niche, then I'll grow with it. So when you want to start a business, focus on satisfying a small niche market, then grow from it. I hope we are all together there. Then the last way you can create a market need is by introducing what we call differentiation. I hope I've spelled it correctly. Yeah, differentiation. Now, as I said, not all the time you need to introduce a new product in a market. If people did that, then we'd have a lot of products. However, you can choose to use an existing product in a market and then differentiate it. A good example is, you could decide to, let's say, what is existing right now in the market. You're going to sell, what can you sell? Maybe you're going to sell a cup. Now, differentiation is whereby you make your cup stand out. Now, if our cups, for example, my cup here, like this cup, it's colorless, right? Now, if I'm going to create a need, what I'll do, this cup is already in the market. So what I'll do, I'll paint my cup to be color yellow, so that when I introduce it to the market, people will see, wow, I've never seen a yellow cup. or I've never had a yellow cup, let me buy it. So you are differentiating your product from the existing ones in the market. Another simple thing is, like, for example, if you are in an estate, an estate where all the shops are like, maybe they've been painted green, right? What you can do, if you want to start the same business in the same market, you can bring in your shop and paint it red. You can bring in your shop instead of, you know, maybe normally people in that locality, they are used to, you know, coming to the market. You can get into that market and differentiate yourself by offering after sale services like delivery. What you're basically doing is you're differentiating. Another example, you might choose to sell rice, okay? Rice is something that is there, that has been there all through our lives. It's not that you're introducing another rice, but you can differentiate by how you package the rice. So you might choose, instead of packing my rice in nylon papers or khaki papers, what I'll do, I will pack my rice in nice plastic tins, you know, I'm going to, you know, maybe even put a recipe on how to cook this rice. What you're basically doing, you are differentiating so that you're creating a need. So anyone who didn't know how to make rice, instead of going to buy a rice that is in a khaki paper with no recipe, they'll come to buy your rice because they'll get a recipe attached to it. So differentiation is something that makes you stand out in an already existing market, thereby you create a need for your product or service. Therefore, I believe with those five ways of creating a market need, you are now able to identify a business opportunity you can get into and make people or make customers come to you. So I think we maybe, hopefully, God willing, next week I'll do part two of this, because I had a lot of things to say, but time is not on our side. So next week we will do part two on, it will be on how you can check viability of your business idea. That will be part two for next week. So mark your calendars, and just know we shall... Next week we'll do part two, where we'll check the viability of a business idea. Then you'll get to share with me your business idea, and then we can know if it's viable or not. So for today, that is the end on how you can identify a business opportunity. I believe if you follow what I've just said, you are now able to know what kind of business you can do in a certain place and how you can do it. Now, for the remaining time, I'll be reading your comments, and I will be reading your comments. Then if you have any question, feel free to ask. We have 5 minutes to go, so bring on your questions. I'll be reading them. Just to remind us, today's topic is how to identify a market need, or how to identify a business opportunity. And we have said the number one policy or rule that you need to satisfy when it comes to starting a business, you need to satisfy a market need. Once you satisfy a market need, you now go to separating it or breaking it down to a permanent market need and a seasonal market need, just to ensure you are able to stay in business for long. I just thought, imagine the person who started a business for selling masks and sanitizer. What will happen to them if they don't adapt really fast and shift really fast after coronavirus is gone? They'll not have anything to do. So it's important for you to look into satisfying a permanent need and a seasonal need at the same time, so that you can stay in business for as long as you wish. So I'll be taking your questions as I sip some cup of water. If you have any questions, just feel free to write in the comments, then I can be able to answer it. So, okay, let me read your comments. Candy, Marble, absolutely. Prince Pesa, Nera, thank you so much for joining in. Jane, you are saying, wow, always learning every day. I'm so happy that you're learning, and I really thank God for such an empowerment so that most people can benefit, and most of all, we can become more better human beings in the world. Jerry, you're saying, absolutely learning, correct. It's a learning session. Marble, you are saying great. Candy, you are saying wow, awesome, thank you so much. Becky, you've invited your friend, thank you so much for inviting her. As I said, keep your questions coming. Feel free to ask any question you might be having regarding starting a business. If you have any fears that you feel you need to air them out, I am here to answer you. Remember, I'm not here to like judge you and say how wrong you are, but I'm here to bring some light, because these are things that people have advised people to use, and so far so good. Their businesses are doing well. So just feel free to ask. Miriam, thank you so much for your great feedback. Marble, I need a business name, then I will start a business which I have identified. How should I go about it? Now, thank you so much for highlighting the business name section. I believe, I think I have seen like two dimensions of your question. But for a business name, one thing you need to sit down and ask yourself, does my business name communicate the product or service I'm selling? So for example, you cannot have a business name like Blessed Travelers, yet you are selling clothes, or Blessed Travelers, yet you are selling land. So a business name, you need to have a business name that easily communicates to your potential customers what you are doing. Example, have you ever heard of a certain business name? Then when you go and check that business, you're like, what? I thought this business is doing this. Because the business name and the actual product and services they are offering, they are two different things, totally different. So ensure your business name is communicating what you're selling or the product you're selling. So for example, I'll give you an example for me. Financial Wellness Center is my business name. Now, it easily communicates that I am dealing with money, and I'm also dealing with wellness of your finances. So if a customer comes to my business, they already know I'm going there because I need assistance with money management or business management. If I could be having Financial Wellness Center, then the products or services I'm offering is exercises, you know, recipes for cooking. You see, they wouldn't be in line with what the business name shows out there. So ensure your business name is reflecting what you are offering. Another example, this is a group like Single and Saved. The name already tells you what to expect in the group. The first thing you expect, the people in the group should be single, of which, of course, there are people who are rebellious. They are married and maybe they could be here, so despite those. But when you see the banner Single and Saved, what comes to your mind is that the people in there, they are single and they are saved. They are Christian minded. They are believers. So then what you get from there is that from single and saved, you expect to see more of Christian content. You expect to see more of Christ-like characteristics in the group. The same way, in your business, let your business name reflect the products and services you are selling. Another dimension that I understood your question, Marble, is that for business name, you also need to learn, once you have a business name for your business, ensure you register it so that somebody does not take it up. I have seen a lot of people, they have a very nice, they have identified a good business opportunity. They've even started it out like on social media, everywhere, but they failed to register the business name. So what happens? Somebody else went and registered that business name, and now they are enjoying from the traffic that business name is bringing to their business. So you might find you've done a lot of work to bring out your brand name, then you don't register it or you don't secure it, then somebody else goes and takes it up and uses it to snatch, like to take away your customers and bring them to their site or to their shop. So ensure that once you come up with a business name and your business is now running, make sure you secure it or you register that business name so that nobody else can take it. To those who've been in the website industry, you really understand the importance of even securing a domain name. You might find that certain domain names are already secured and you have to bid for them, and or you cannot use them because they've already been taken by somebody else. Keep your questions coming. I think we have like 2 more minutes before we end the session because our time is up. Meanwhile, write down your questions. If you feel that you need to send me an inbox, maybe you have you need more guidance or you need more assistance, my inbox is open, so you can send me an inbox anytime. And I'll try my best to answer everything on time. Again, I would also request you to visit my YouTube channel. I have attached the link on top of this live session so that you can get to watch more videos on business and money management at your free time. Remember, you don't have to wait until we have Financial Friday. You can subscribe to my YouTube channel. Then get to watch a lot of videos I've done there. They're about business management and money management so that you can be empowered. And of course, you can get to share, the knowledge and everything you learn there with your friends. Yvonne, I've really learned a lot. God bless you so much. Thank you so much. And thank you for your time to be with us here. Caroline, you're saying great. Thank you so much for your support and presence. We still have just a minute, then the session will end. To those that will watch this live session later on, you can post your questions in the comments later on. I will get some time and go through every comment and reply to anyone that I feel they need a reply from me. Joshua, you're saying good session. Thank you so much for your presence and the great compliment. I really appreciate it. And until then, our time is up. Thank you so much for your presence and your support. To those that tagged their friends, thank you so much. And most of all, to those that asked their question, I really want to thank you. If you still have a question, feel free to post in the comments. I'll go through it later on. Or if you need further guidance or assistance when it comes to business management and money management, feel free to send me an inbox. And most of all, remember to visit my Facebook page, Financial Wellness Center, so that you can get to acquire more money skills and business tips. Until then, I'll see you next Friday. Stay safe and God bless you.